house divided against itself cannot stand, for in unity lies strength. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of Live from Karbala. We are coming to you live from the holy city of Karbala in our show Ziyarat al-Arba'een 1438-2016 with me, your host Ahmed Ali. Now, for the dear viewers who are just tuning in for the first time, we have been discussing unity as the main principle of humanity. Yesterday, we shed some light upon the campaign bearing the slogan Hussein Unites Us. We also touched upon some of the reasons why humanity is disunited despite sharing the same values such as freedom, equality, justice, and equity. We also touched upon how and why Imam Hussein alayhi salam is the axis of unity. This was all discussed with my dear guest, Mr. Masoud Khaqani, head of Imam Hussein TV3. Welcome back, Habib Ustaz. Alaykum As-salam wa rahmatullah. It's an honor to have you once again on our show. Yesterday we had a very interesting topic to talk about. It was somewhat a continuation from what I began, but yesterday we touched upon some very key points. If I would take some of them, it would be that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, is it safe to say that he is the origin of unity, or can we say that he was the continuation of that origin that existed before him?
I think it's better to mention that he was the continuation, mm-hmm. and he was the, and he is the main symbol and the main axis of the unity.
Mm-hmm. But we see a different unity from like the rest of the prophets, or Prophet Muhammad himself, because the way that he preached was somewhat different, if you will, than what Prophet Muhammad preached. Not then, but in the form of way. Hussein alayhi salam, of course, he rose against despite having less supporters. But the aspect of unity, yesterday we talked about it and how it played a role within the Imam's, the minimum army that he did have on Deva Ashura, but I would like you to recap that if you can for us. That would be great,
inshallah. In this, as the continuation of the last night's discussion, mm-hmm. I have to mention that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, although he was the continuation of the holy progeny of the holy prophet, mm-hmm. and he has conveying the same message, he was conveying the same message, mm-hmm. but while wise, he has the new, or I can say somehow more attractive message aside, mm-hmm. which was not based on the beliefs, based on the religion. His message was very clear and understandable for every human being, despite of their religion, nationality, or race. Mm-hmm. And this message, or this motto, was freedom, was justice, and was sacrification. Mm-hmm. So, as you mentioned, Imam Hussein alayhi salam was the continuation of the message of unity, but he adds something to that message which made it more attractive for all of the mankind. And this addition by Imam Hussein alayhi salam made him more popular around the globe. And alhamdulillah, you can see that a lot of people from different and various nationalities and races do love Imam Hussein. And I'm sure whoever we speak about Imam Hussein with him, or her, he cannot stop loving him, he cannot stop liking Imam Hussein alayhi salam, because of the humanitarian virtues of the Imam Hussein and his message and his revolution.
That's actually very true. But despite all of that, yesterday we talked about, you know, us humans, whether we, you know, we're from a different sect, different race, different nationality, different country, if you will, yet we share the same values, as you just mentioned right now. But we mentioned yesterday that if we do share all of this, you know, the values and the virtues that we share with each other as humans, but yet we are still disunited. And we talked about some of the reasons. The viewers can go back to our YouTube channel to review that episode. But I would like to, the same topic, but shift it up a little bit. And that's the prominent problems that we are facing, or that are current in our world today. I mean, the lives that we live, problems are, you know, we're facing problems on a daily basis. It's not like a problem today and the next problem is like in months. No, like if there's a problem today, then we have to worry about what comes tomorrow, because the cause and effect of each problem occurs.
Yes. If you want to classify the different types of problems we have in the world today, there will be a long list, unfortunately.
Yes.
And I'm not sure if we can mention them all in this in our
45-minute episode.
Yeah. So I try to speak some of, to bring some of them and say how Imam Hussein can bring solution to those problems. One of these problems is discrimination.
Yes.
We can say problems. One of the biggest problems in the world today, and we can see huge gap, huge difference between the wealth, between the respect of the human beings in the world, as long as we have in our Quran saying that everyone are the same. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, we can see that we have people, multi billionaires, and on the other hand, we have a lot of people, millions of people, with no penny in their hand.
Yeah, below the poverty.
Yeah, with under the poverty line, mm-hmm. Very under the poverty line.
Yeah, way below.
Yeah, very below the poverty line. So, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, with his, if we just look at the life of Imam Hussein, apart from Ashura, we can see that Imam Hussein alayhi salam shared all of his wealth together with his brother, Imam Hassan alayhi salam. They shared all of their wealth twice or three times in their life with poor people. And also, we can claim that every single day Imam Hussein had a lot of any type of donation to the
definitely.
To the people. And together with all of this, mm-hmm. Imam Hussein, Imam Hassan, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the father of Imam Hussein, and father of the Imams, mm-hmm. and all of Ahlul Bayt, the progeny of Rasulullah, all of them, if we see their lives, we can see that they lived like a very, very simple human in their own society. Imam Ali alayhi salam, while he was the king, or he was the leader of the biggest country on that world, at the same time, he was living in a very, very poor house and eating a very, very simple food.
And you know, for anyone that wants to see the house of Imam Mu'mineen, it's present in Kufa right now.
Yeah.
Near Masjid al-Kufa, you can see how simple he lived.
The
ruler of the Muslim Ummah back then.
And you can compare it with the person like Muawiyah, who was living at the same era and who was leading some parts of the country at the same era in Damascus. And you can compare. Or you can compare it with the palaces in Egypt, or in Iran, in Persia, or in the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
And you can understand what is the main difference between the message of Imam Hussein, message of Islam, together in comparison with other theologies and methodologies. Mm-hmm. And one of the other problems, mm-hmm. in our society, not only our society as the Muslim community, mm-hmm. in the whole world, you can see the problem of how can I mention it? I don't want to use bad words, but at the same time I can't describe this problem better than this as saying that lying. Our world, our system is based on big lies, unfortunately. And we, especially the mainstream media, are trying, aside from proving those, how can I say, those bases, they take it as a very, very important value, and they construct all of the society, all of the system over those unauthorized topics or subjects. One of them is the one of the lies that the mainstream media is trying to work on it and established it and is propagated is the is the base is the how can I humanism we say they claim that human being is the most important thing the most important thing in the world. And nothing is important more than human. So whatever and whoever is benefiting human being is good, and whatever is not, we can do whatever we can with it. And this is one of the roots of in this unity, disunity in the world, because every human being, based on this principle, they first and last think about themselves. Not thinking about their society, not thinking about the community and unity. They think about themselves, and as long as they are thinking about themselves, they do whatever benefits them. Of course, if they try to think or generally, they can understand getting the unity may has a lot of benefits for them, but because most of the human beings try not to think generally, and they think just dedicated on some special notes. So they prefer to do whatever is useful for themselves and according to their knowledge. So as long as you see a lot of intellectuals, a lot of knowledgeable people who are not thinking like the mainstream, they want to change the community, they want to change the society, but they were not successful in their message, and we hope that in future we will have the awaited savior Imam Mahdi alayhi salam, who come and solve this most important problem. If we solve the problems from the principles, if we change the main lying principles in the society, then we can construct whole of the society in a very better way, a very better shape.
Definitely.
The result of the previous presidential election in the US is one of the indicators of this problem. Most of the people in the US, I can say, they are not happy with the system. They are not happy with the system, and their vote in the election was not meaning that they are with somebody else. They are pro the winner. They were not pro the winner, but they think that they choose between bad and worse.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, and because they thought that the winner, Mr. Trump, will bring them a change, they are thinking that change will be useful for them. I don't think so, but I think that those people who vote for Mr. Trump, they were thinking for a new society. They were thinking, they were trying to get a new system in their country, as well as the whole globe, as well.
Just to touch upon two points before we go into a break, is first that unity is based on a trustworthy bond between the two parties that they share. The second part is for Donald Trump, because just a few days ago after winning, 2 days or less than 2 days after winning the elections, he right away went on his website, or the manager of his website, took down the notes or the article talking about banning Muslims from entering the U.S. So in favor of the radicals that live in the U.S. who have a bad image about Islam, or have received a bad image about Islam, he used some kind of method into attracting them to get into power. And at the end, I don't know how it happened. I was checking the news and it disappeared from his website. But we'll continue this very interesting discussion after this short break. So if you will, respected viewers, brothers and sisters, we will go into a short break, inshallah, to provide you what is going on inside and outside the Holy City of Karbala prior to the Arbaeen of Imam Hussein, 1438-2016. Stay tuned for after the break.
Assalamu alaikum, dear viewers. Peace be upon you, and welcome to the land of paradise. Welcome to the holy lands of Karbala, to the areas neighboring the holy shrine of Imam Hussein. As you see, we witness increasing the numbers of the pilgrims of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, as the pilgrimage of Arbaeen approaches day by day. The largest gathering in human history will take place in the holy city of Karbala, to take part in participating to revive the 40th day, and the 40th day after the martyrdom of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Dear viewers, today we will go to see the Husseini processions, and we will get to know when did they started their services, when the Husseini procession was first established, and then we are going to have more details and information about number of the servants of Imam Hussein and what type of services they provide to the pilgrims, as well as a historical view about the Husseini processions, and to get to know more about that part of the Arbaeen pilgrimage. There's something that some people might not know, which is that on the pilgrimage of Ashura, the Husseini processions are basically come from the holy city of Karbala. The people, the population of Karbala, tend to serve Imam Hussein pilgrims on the pilgrimage of Ashura. As for the Arbaeen, Husseini processions from all over the world, including a big number of them starts from Iraq, comes from Iraq. Husseini processions from different Iraqi provinces and different nations come together to serve Imam Hussein on that pilgrimage, to serve the largest gathering in the human history. Dear viewers, stay tuned to get to know more about the Husseini processions.
Your name, and to you
Assalamu alaikum, dear viewers. Welcome. As you see, the Husseini procession behind me is a Husseini procession that is basically from Basra, from a district called Haritha. This district has made up a slogan for itself, which says, Khidmat Zuwar al-Hussein Sharaful Lana. The service of Imam Hussein pilgrims is an honor for us. Dear viewers, stay tuned. We will have an interview with the Husseini procession leader, and we will get to know more information about this Husseini procession from him. Dear viewers, I'm going to ask my brother here about the establishment date of this Husseini procession, as well as the number of participants of the servants of Imam Hussein in this Husseini procession. Assalamu alaikum, akhi al-aziz. Ash waqt tasas hadha al-mawqif al-Husseini wa ish qad 'adad al-khaddam bi?
تأسس هذا الموقف الحسيني سنة 2003 سنة 2003 عدد القدام الموجودين 10 أشخاص أول سنة تأسس بها
بالوقت الحالي ايش صار عدد
هسه عدد القدام الموجودين 20 شخص
My brother here just said that this Husseini procession was established in 2003 and the number of servants of Imam Hussein at that time was 10 people, but at later times it increases into 20 people at the present time. So now we have 20 people providing services to Imam Hussein pilgrims. Now I'm going to ask him about the types of services. What type of services they provide to the pilgrims of Imam Hussein? Azizi, شنو الخدمات اللي تقدموها لزوار الإمام الحسين عليه السلام؟
الخدمات نقدمها لزوار أبو عبد الله. الحسين نقدم وجبة ريوق ونقدم وجبة عشاء وجبة الريوق وجبة الريوق الشاي والحليب والكيك المحشى والكيك المسمسم والأجبان العشاء يعني نقدم الأكلة اللي يحبها يعني العشائر ويحبونها زوار أبو عبد الله الحسين أكلة الباتشة يعني الباتشة
My brother here just spoke of the services they provide to Imam Hussein pilgrims. He said that this Husseini procession serves two meals a day, which is they serve breakfast and dinner, basically. At the breakfast, they provide tea, the warm drinks such as tea, warm milk, as well as a number of types of cake as well. As for the dinner, they provide a typical meal in Iraq, a traditional meal, which is basically called parcha, which is you know a traditional meal of Iraq. Now, I'm going to ask my brother here about you know a circumstance, a position where it was so hard for him or for them as a Husseini procession to control, and by the blessing of Imam Hussein, they could have controlled it. أخي العزيز فد موقف صار وياكم واجهتوا في الصعوبة وبركة الإمام الحسين قدرتوا أن تتغلبون على هذا الموقف
أول ما تأسس الموقف كان كنا نملك 25,000 دينار 25,000 دينار في بركات أبا عبد الله الحسين يعني تمت الخيرات كلها تمت الخيرات كلها بهذا الموقف قدرنا يعني نشتغل ونقدم ما يشتهي الزار يعني الحمد لله والشكر ويعني وجاهزين لقدام زوار أبا عبد الله من الصباح إلى المساء إن شاء الله.
My brother here said that he just narrated a story at the establishment of this Husseini procession. He said that at the time when this procession was established, they did not have enough money. To establish it. They did not have enough money to provide the services. So, with the blessings of Imam Hussein, they could have gathered more money and they could have provided the best services they could provide to Imam Hussein pilgrims. And that is one of the Husseini blessings they have in this Husseini procession. Dear brothers and sisters, stay tuned as we get to see more Husseini processions from different provinces of Iraq, from different areas, to get to know more details about them.
Drops like this, oh Hussein, with your love I'm always praying.
Respected viewers, brothers and sisters, once again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the second part of tonight's episode. Before the break, we discussed some of the key and the prominent problems that society faces in our current time today. And unfortunately, we mentioned some of the worst problems that society can face, and that's the loss of trustworthiness within a society. But moving on to the next topic, which is related to unity. Back with my dear guest, Mr. Khaqani. Welcome back, Halbi Ustad.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for joining us tonight. For everything that a person does, whether it is good or whether it is bad, for example, entrepreneur or just a regular businessman, when he wants to go into doing something, he always thinks about the benefits of such an idea,
sure,
of such a project, of such a business. What is or what are we going to benefit from unity as an Islamic society, as, and forget about Islam, as human beings? How are we going to benefit from unity?
I can bring you a very famous example,
mm-hmm,
of showing some of the benefits of the unity,
mm-hmm,
which is European Union. If you see these 28 countries, 26 or 28
yes,
countries, were supposed to be big enemies together. Most of them, it causes the First and Second World War,
yeah,
and more than, I think, 70 million people.
Over 80 million people died.
Over 80 million people killed,
yeah,
because of these two wars.
Yeah.
This is aside from other wars in this continent. But after a while, they felt and they decided to solve most of their problems with one concept, which was unity. This concept of unity, they didn't bring it in a way that we are talking about. It was not unity as we are describing,
mm-hmm,
but this is very similar.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, okay, at the same time, we are countries, we don't change our system, we don't change, for example, one country is kingdom, the other one is republic, the other one is something else. But we together have some aims and we try to go ahead to the aims. We keep the borders, but people from this country pass the borders easily without visa to the other.
Yes.
Also, we open the export and we can easily export goods from this country to the other one,
yes,
without a lot of bureaucracy laws and things like that. And in their materialistic life, they've got a lot of benefits out of that.
Definitely.
Nowadays, in past, I think, 3-4 years, they, especially the new generation of the politicians in most of the European countries, they changed the policies.
Mm-hmm.
They began thinking about their own policies instead of thinking about the union.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why at the moment you can see a lot of messages from here and there in the union that they are going to get apart. And the first one was the Brexit by the UK.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that this union will continue its golden era,
yeah,
in the future. But this was an example. In the time that they began, especially for example 10 years ago, they became from short countries to a big power in the world.
Yeah.
The same time economic power as well as political power. I'm not confirming their policies. I'm just talking about the benefits they got from their unity. So while they began to be united, for example, a country like Greece or a country like Bulgaria has the same ability in the Union as a powerful country like France or Germany or the UK. So most of the human, most of the people in these countries get benefit out of this unity. If we can have a worldwide country, no border, no costume, no export laws, anything like a country, all of the world countries get together and make a big continental country. In that country, everyone can pass from, everyone can live wherever he or she wants. Everyone can produce whatever he or she wants. Everyone can do whatever they want. And this is the ultimate goal of the unity, which definitely will be happening, inshallah, in future.
Inshallah. Inshallah. Hopefully in the future, this kind of thing will happen, this kind of unity. But we always mention, and yesterday we talked about how Imam Hussein alayhi salam and the Ahlul Bayt, especially Imam Hussein, we placed this statement forward. It wasn't us that began it, but the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam gave us a very crucial note on this, and that is the Ahlul Bayt or Imam Hussein alayhi salam is the axis of unity. Now, how was Imam Hussein able to attract the attentions of the millions and millions of people across the world to gather them in one place, in one occasion, and everybody is so unified? I mean, to attract some people, and I've read this on blogs, on and on forums, on the internet, they say that, you know, it doesn't make any sense. You know, it's not Imam Hussein, it's something else that people are here coming to do something. Not the rituals. They attack the rituals. They say that Imam Hussein couldn't attract more than 72 individuals. How is he attracting, you know, we excess in, you know, we exaggerate in the numbers that we mentioned, and the you know, the numbers of people who enter Karbala. So how was Imam Hussein able to do this?
Okay, let's go through details of Arbaeen. Mm-hmm. What is Arbaeen? People are walking, or I can say most of them, I can't say all of them, but around Iraq, especially Iraqi people, together with a lot of people from different countries. Today I read, I hear a news, official news from the shrine that so far, from the 1st of Safar so far, 2 million visas were applied from Iraqi embassies around the world for the Ziyarat al-Arba'een. 2 million so far. And this is aside from the Iraqi people who, if you can look around, you can see this is, it doesn't need any type of approval or confirmation. Whoever has doubt, it's easy, and I think it just, or turn the TV on, or to be more authentic, take a ticket. Ahlan wa sahlan, welcome. He's more than welcome to Karbala and see what's going on here. But this is not a simple, or this is not a easy task to do. Whoever joins here has a lot of problems. They have to walk at least 80 kilometers, which is not a few distance. Takes 3-4 elderly, more five days maybe, and for those who are coming from other cities, like for example Basra or Divaniyeh or borders, they have to walk more. when they arrive in Karbala, they are a drop out of a million, a drop out of the ocean. They have a lot of problems in the city. The streets are crowded. Yeah. The moving in the streets are very, very difficult, as you can see here. And they take all of these problems and suffers, not only because, not because there is a party here, not mm-hmm. because they can benefit, they can get a financial benefit out of here, mm-hmm. but because they found something in Imam Hussein, in the concept of Imam Hussein, which is unique in the world. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that no theology, no political leader, no celebrity, no, how can I say, historical individual mm-hmm. can gather such a gathering like like Arbaeen.
It's never recorded
in the world. So this is something which is which needs a lot of researchers to think and to go through it, to find different aspects of the this huge event which is happening every year. And this is not Imam Hussein's pilgrimage, is not only Ziyarat al-Arba'een. All of the year, 365 days, mm-hmm. Imam Hussein's shrines is busy. Definitely. With the pilgrims, but definitely. The Arba'een is the biggest one. Mm-hmm. But you can see a lot of people every night of Friday. You can see at least 2 million people in Karbala. Mm-hmm. So Imam Hussein is not, as you mentioned, I'm gonna answer those doubts and questions mm-hmm. that these people are coming for something but Imam Hussein. They are coming to get, I don't know, a kind of financial benefit or mm-hmm. hobby or have fun here. But you know, this is not easy to come here.
They
get a lot of difficulties.
Yeah.
They have to at least walk 80 kilometers, which is not few.
It's not a little.
So they have they come here, and they do respect they respect a personality or a concept which is global, which is not only religious but also global. Mm-hmm. So if, as Imam, I think Imam Baqir alayhi salam said, "Lo alamu nas mahasana kalamana la tabauna." If people around the world hear, or we get them, we come them to know about the narrations, about the personality of our beloved imams, they will follow them. No need, nothing else. Just, I don't know, I can't understand any person who's here to the story of Imam Hussein and can't like him, and cannot be in love with him mm-hmm. even. Because Imam Hussein did something unique in the history.
Definitely.
200 at most people, they fought with more than 30,000. This is not believable. But when you see that someone did that, so you have to believe it, and you have to think about why mm-hmm. this happened. And when people think about it and go through the details, they will understand who Imam Hussein is and why he is that beloved. Mm-hmm. So, to conclusion of this part of the discussion, I just want to say that if we as Shia Muslims, if we as those who know Imam Hussein alayhi salam, just distribute the story of Imam Hussein, we can gather a lot of human beings.
Definitely.
Not only 30 million people, but also all of the 7 billion people, they will
hopefully
love Imam Hussein.
Inshallah, hopefully. I will continue the discussion after the short break. If you, inshallah, respect viewers, stay tuned after the break for we will, inshallah, link Imam Hussein, Unity, and Imam Mahdi all together. That's after the break. So stay tuned.
It has. The servants are, I get to know that the servants are more eager to receive the pilgrimage of Arbaeen each year to serve Imam Hussein pilgrims, Please stay tuned to get to know more information from the servants of Imam Hussein about this Husseini procession. Assalamu alaikum, dear viewers. I'm going to ask my brother here about the establishment date of this Husseini procession and the number of participants of Imam Hussein's servants in this Husseini procession. Assalamu alaikum. شو وقت تأسس هذا الموكب وإيش قد عدد الخدام اللي بيه؟
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فمن يعظم شعار الله فإنها من تقوى القلوب. طبعا هذا الموكب إلى تاريخ عريق ببغداد بالكاظمية المقدسة، يعني حتى كان جدنا علي يقولون ينزل بالصحن عند الإمامين. هذا الموكب 1918 وهو كان يسمى موكب آل ماجد، آل ماجد باسم جدنا الكبير وصار باسم عائلة، فهذا إلى تاريخ. بالنسبة بالكاظمية المقدسة نخدم بوفاة الإمام موسى بن جعفر حوالي 7 أيام، وبوفاة الإمام الجواد كذلك. عندنا بوفاة موسى بن جعفر عندنا مجالس حسينية، وروادنا مثل جعفر الإبراهيمي، علي السماوي، الطفيلي، معظم القراء، وإضافة للقراء اللطم يعني الجيدين يعني حضرون يطون منه. وعندنا بالنسبة للطق نجب بكربلاء المقدسة من يوم 9/0، ندخل طبعا هي بهذا المكان المقدس بين الحرمين بين شارع العباس باب القبلة، ونقوم بالخدمة من يوم 10 بالضبط/0 إلى يوم 11. عندنا طبخ بالذات يوم 21 العفو من صفر، عندنا طبخ نبدأ الصبح طبعا سواء بيض مسلوق أو يوم شوربة الصبح أو يوم حليب الصبح، والظهر تمن ومرقع اعتيادي، والعشاء عادة النواشف شيش قص مثلا نشوف هناك بذاك الجانب أو هاي، وهاي تبدأ الخدمة للموكب إن شاء الله.
My brother here just spoke of this Husseini procession's history. He said that this Husseini procession was established 1918 in the holy city of Kadhimiyya near Imam Kadhim. As well, this Husseini procession was established by this man's grandfather. It is the Husseini procession is called Al Majid Husseini procession. It has a building in the city of Kadhimiyya near Imam Kadhim. This Husseini procession also provides lectures, religious lectures, intellectual lectures by a number of Husseini orators. Famous Husseini orators come to their Husseiniyya to provide the intellectual lectures and religious lectures, as well as they provide services starting from the 9th of Safar until the 21st of Safar. They provide 3 meals a day, a breakfast, a lunch and a dinner. Basically, the lunch can be the Iraqi traditional food as well as the dinner. At the moment, I'm going to ask you about the number of participants. How many Husseini servants in this Husseini procession? أخي العزيز، إيش قد عدد الخدام عندكم هذا الموكب؟
الخدام طبعاً يبين 50 إلى 80 نفر قادم عندنا، وكلهم من هناك يجون من الكامية. تعرف هسه الزيارة أغلبيتها مشي الأربعينية، فتجينا على شكل وجبات. أي بس إحنا الأهل الموكب نحضر من يوم 9 ننصب موكبنا ونجهز للطعام، يعني إحنا نجيب أطنان من التمن والحمص والعدس، يعني مو تقول مثلاً 10 أكياس، أطنان يعني 4 أطنان تمن، 3 أطنان حمص، العدس بكمية كبيرة، الزيت بكمية، فنجيب حوالي 4-5 سيارات كبيرة، نفرغ موادنا ونجهز للعمل. بتعرف زيارة الأربعين إلها ثقل ولها وزنها الخاص، فإحنا نقوم نقدر قد ما نقدر نبذل هاي، وهذه الزيارة حقيقة إحنا ننتظرها بتشوق. كيف ما نعرف حقيقة، يعني إحنا شلون يعني ننتظرها ما نعرف. بس هي ننتظرها بتشوق ما أعرف نخدم بيها نحس بنفسنا سوينا فشي عند إمامنا الحسين.
My brother here spoke of the number of servants, Husseini servants in this Husseini procession. He said that there is 80 people, 80 Husseini servants who serve the pilgrims of Imam Hussein in this Husseini procession. As you know, the pilgrimage of Arbaeen during the current time in Iraq, most of the roads are being blocked. So the Husseini servants come gradually until their numbers are completed before the pilgrimage of Arbaeen in a week or something less than that. This man says that as for him and his brothers, they come earlier than others. They come on the 9th of Safar because they bring with them large quantities of food. You know, tons of rice and chickpeas and white beans, etc. Of food materials that are being prepared to be served to the pilgrims. He also spoke of his eagerness. He said that he is eager. He and his fellow brothers, they are eager to serve Imam Hussein procession. They are eager to receive the pilgrimage of Arbaeen, to participate, to put their efforts at the service of Imam Hussein alayhi salam.
Respected viewers, brothers and sisters, once again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I do thank my brother Muhammad Ali for providing us the atmosphere prior to Ziyarat al-Arba'een, the great Arba'een pilgrimage, the greatest human gathering ever known in history. We do request from the people who do like to remark such things and do like to write articles about such events, we do welcome them in the holy city of Karbala to record what goes on and share to the entire world. But back to the discussion with my dear guest, Mr. Masoud Khaqani, head of Imam Hussein 3 TV. Welcome back, how are you, Ustad?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before the break, we talked about how Imam Hussein alayhi salam was able and was the reason behind gathering every single individual or grasping the hearts and the souls from people from every single corner of the world. I mean, in Karbala today, I was on the way from Karbala, from Najaf to Karbala, where Hussein al-Sukhni is and Sheikh Muntazar are. So when I was there, I saw people from Nigeria, people from China, Chinese people were walking, Koreans were walking. There's actually a Korean mokib just a few blocks away from here.
Mm-hmm.
A Korean mokib, or under just a dariba we call it here.
Mm-hmm.
Just a few miles away from the holy shrine, where a Korean
very
mokib.
Very close.
It is, yeah, very close. I think 2 kilometers away, less than 2 kilometers, established under the bridge. So if anyone's in Karbala, you can go check it out. Nigerian mokib, on the way from Hilla to Karbala, there's a Christian mokib. And I mean, majority of mokib. So we find that Imam Hussein does not only inspire us as Muslims or us as Shia or us as Iraqis or us as, you know, wherever we may be, but Imam Hussein alayhi salam became that inspiration that every single individual, whether we go to Gandhi, whether we go to any individual who's inspired by Hussein alayhi salam, in the honor of Imam Hussein, they serve his pilgrims. Now we mentioned that how Imam Hussein inspired these millions to gather here. The last 5 minutes that
of course,
we have,
I'm sorry to cut you off, but the there should be a big research over how. We know a lot of people are gathered,
mm-hmm.
but it takes a lot of time to analyze how Imam Hussein did inspire them. And this is a very important thing.
Yeah.
If we can analyze this important gathering, this huge gathering, then we can apply it to our ordinary life, to be united, to have action plans for all of the human beings to be united.
Definitely. And if we, as you were just saying that, I was imagining the people coming from Basra, and this is not, you know, 1 kilometer, 10 kilometers away from Karbala. If we comprehend the idea, this is 596 kilometers. I don't know how they have the will to walk. How strong is their will?
How strong is it?
From, you know, from Basra, and from the border, it's approximately over 600 kilometers from Safwan.
Yes, Kuwait borders.
The Kuwait border, Iraqi-Kuwaiti border, to coming from Kuwait to Iraq to Karbala right away. I mean, to just comprehend that and thinking about it makes me get the shivers, because what kind of individuals would walk that long, leaving from the first of Safar? So you're basically walking 20 days.
20 days in walk,
On the road. And people wonder, and legit, for just ordinary individuals, it's very hard to understand. It's very hard when someone says, Imam Hussein, we do understand that. But there's something different that plays a very crucial role.
It needs, as I told you, it needs a lot of analyzation.
Definitely.
You know, when you see children, a child, its nature is going here and there. But you see a lot of children sitting in the maukib, or they try to help. They are very eager to help,
to do massage,
to do, I don't know, I can't understand. And you see, in the previous regime, Saddam era, there were a lot of, more than 30 years and even more, that the media of the country was against the Imam Hussein's rituals.
Definitely.
And before that, the same. And after that, the media did not play a very important role in changing the minds. I don't know what's going on in the minds of Iraqis that do sacrifice whatever they have in the path of Imam Hussein, and especially in the Ziyarat of Arbaeen.
Just taking that in and trying to think about it, the words you mentioned is the fact that something divine comes into play.
Yes.
Like, no mankind, I mean, if you send the invitations plus money on top, like excessive money on top, you won't get visitors like this.
For sure you couldn't get. For sure you couldn't get.
I mean, if you spend millions and millions of dollars on one project just to get people coming, they mean the awards, the VMA awards and the other awards, the global awards, when you do see a lot of people watch it, a lot of people attend, but how many compared to 30 million?
No, you can ask them, are you, if you are going to get this prize, we will give you this prize if you walk 80 kilometers.
They won't.
If you walk 200 kilometers, will they accept it?
I don't think they will. Because
if it is the prize is something around $1 million,
they'll probably do it. $1 million, I'll do it. But we have come to the end of the show. I would like to thank you very much for tuning in and joining us, Ustaz Masoud Khaqani.
Thank you for having me.
Head of Imam Hussein TV3. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the ability and strength to continue serving Imam Hussein and his channel, Imam Hussein TV3. Thank you very much, respected viewers, for tuning in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shed his blessings and mercy upon you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength to unite under the banner of Imam al-Mahdi. May Allah hasten his reappearance. So thank you very much. Do not forget to join Sheikh Muntadhar, my dear brother, in the morning show in a few hours at 7 a.m. Karbala time in his show. And we are running around the hour to provide you with live footages of the Arbaeen march towards Karbala. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you.